Welcome on this very special day. We're pleased to be bringing you full coverage of the massive canonization for Kateri Teka Kwitha. Most of us in Canada have grown up hearing about Blessed Kateri Teka Kwitha, and today she finally becomes a saint. So we're going to go now to St. Peter's Square at the Vatican, where the Mass for her canonization is about to begin.
Who was born in the United States and later lived and died in Canada, known as the Lily of the Mohawks. And so these are the seven saints that we have today.
And as you said, certainly a very wide representation, not only geographically, but certainly in state of life as well. We have priests, catechists, religious sisters and founders, lay women, and so a representation of the diversity and universality of the Church, again, not just geographically, but also in state of life, in their missions in life, and a fairly wide representation of dates as well. So we see saints from the 17th century all the way up into the 20th century. Mariana Cope and Anna Schaefer both died in the 20th century. Of course, we have a number of saints who are of particular interest to English-speaking listeners. Mariana Cope lived most of her life in the United States and died in the missions in Hawaii, working amongst the lepers, as you said, Don. Kateri Teka Kwitha, a Native American saint, and in fact the first Native American to be canonized. And we also have Pedro Calungsod, a lay catechist and martyr who was martyred in the Philippines. And perhaps, Don, if you'd like to talk a little bit about some of our English-speaking saints and saints from the English-speaking world.
Well, we can start with the Mariana Cope, who, as you said, Chris, was born in Germany and then emigrated at 1 year old with her father and her family to upstate New York, particularly in Utica. And I know we have some visitors from New York here. The Bishop of Syracuse is here. In 1862, she joined the Sisters of St. Francis and rapidly advanced, becoming very proficient at the administration of hospitals. In 1877, she was elected Mother Superior and established several hospitals in upstate New York that were known for their modern methods and administration. She was known for keeping exceptionally clean and sanitary hospitals in a period where that was not common. In 1883, she responded to a call from the Kingdom of Hawaii to help lepers, to help the leper colonies. In particular, she was concerned with the children of lepers who had been left destitute by the sickness of their parents. She was a cooperator and then successor to St. Damien de Wooster, who himself was canonized several years ago. She died in 1918 and was beatified in 2005. Now coming to her canonization here, a message of great hope for the Church of the United States, many members of the Church from both New York and Hawaii here to celebrate this for her.
And also associated with the state of New York is the Native American First Nations Saint Tekeri Tekathwitha, who also has a New York connection.
Yes, she was originally born in the territory which would eventually become the state of New York, and she was born about 1656, had a very hard life as a child. Her mother was an Algonquin Christian who died when she was very young. Kateri also suffered from smallpox as a child, an affliction which left her somewhat scarred. In 1667, Kateri met Jesuit missionaries, and they left such an impression on her that she lived a very Christian life even before baptism, in the midst of a very aggressive type of paganism practiced by the Iroquois, and consistently refused to marry, which was very unusual at that time. In 1674, she was baptized by the Jesuit fathers, and she lived a life of very severe penance, which impressed both the natives and the Jesuits, finally dying in 1680 in Quebec.
And again, that's Kateri Teka Kwitha, As you mentioned, Don, she was evangelized by the Jesuits and received into the church by the Jesuits. And we'll see them again. This is certainly a big day for the Jesuit order, as a number of the saints have a connection with the Jesuits, as Kateri does. And in fact, one of the new saints is, in fact, a Jesuit priest. You mentioned as well there's another saint of great interest to English-speaking peoples. The Philippines is one of the largest Catholic nations in the world by population. We certainly see a large number of them here in the crowd and coming in through the streets of Rome. They're here for the canonization of Pedro Calungsod, who, like Kateri, died relatively young. Pedro, however, was a martyr. Can you tell us a little bit about that, Don?
Well, here again, as you said, we have another Jesuit connection. What I believe to be only the second canonized Philippine saint, Pedro was born in Visayas in the Philippines and trained as a lay catechist for the Jesuit missions, particularly to the Jesuit missions of the Pacific Ocean, of Oceania. In 1668, he went with the Jesuits on a mission to the Chamorros in the Marianas Islands. And in 1672, he was in Guam, where at 17 years old, he was killed by a native who was enraged over Christian missions. Some of the natives and people external to the island of Guam had been suggesting that Christians were poisoning baptismal water. And because of these charges, they attacked the priest, Father Diego, who was himself canonized several years ago. And Pedro refused to leave his priest. He was shot in the chest with a spear and then finally dispatched with a sword. And in 2000, he was beatified.
And as we mentioned, there's a great number of people here from throughout the world. We're looking out on the assembly now. You see flags from nations from everywhere. In addition to the Canadian and American saints, the Filipino saint, we have saints from Spain, from France, from Germany, and Italy, and so quite a representation. Now, as we're preparing for the canonization, again, looking out at the crowd, one of the characteristic features of the canonization is the banners hung on the facade of St. Peter's with the official images of the seven new saints, a very remarkable sight for anyone who's familiar with the facade of St. Peter's, and to see the brilliant color images, the color banners with each of the seven saints is a wonderful moment. Looking out over the crowd, you'll also notice, for those of us who can see us on television, you'll also notice the large number of priests and bishops and cardinals in attendance. Of course, there are saints from cardinals and bishops from around the world and here for this. And the ceremony is now beginning with the litany of the saints.
Santa
And the Holy Father has now approached the entrance to St. Peter's. He's walking out into the square in procession. The first part of the canonization of the Litany of Saints has begun, and there is an interlude as the fathers, priests, bishops, cardinals, and of course the Holy Father approach and reverence the altar.
Now there are some slight changes and revisions to this canonization ceremony, some revisions and simplifications, in some cases going back to earlier practices. In this case, you see the Litany of Saints being performed during the procession in. Later on in the ceremony, there will be a slight change during the veneration of the relics, reverting to an earlier practice where the Te Deum will be sung while the relics are brought by the deacons and the helpers to be venerated by the Pope.
And of course, the most notable difference is the simple fact of the position of the canonization itself ahead of the Mass, which is also a recurrence to an earlier practice, which highlights both the importance and significance of the canonization and also the unique significance of the Holy Mass and the Mass of Thanksgiving. As we see the Holy Father walking in, if you look very closely, you can see the addition of another small point of interest. The Holy Father, Pope Benedict, is wearing what is called a fanon. It's very much like a little shoulder cape, which is a distinctive element of the papal vestments. And that is something that's been brought back new for this ceremony.
The fanon is a particular piece of papal vesture that dates back all the way to the 8th century, and by the 1200s had become solely applicable to the Pope. And so this is a special vestment used by no one else in the world, signifying the office of the papacy.
And it has been in use, as you said, since for over 1,000 years now. Although in recent years it has become less common, we certainly have very beautiful images of its being used by Pope John the 23rd, Blessed Pope John the 23rd, Paul the 6th, Blessed Pope John Paul the 2nd, who was the last one to wear the fanon. And as a special garment distinctive to the Pope, Pope Benedict has chosen to bring it out again as an indication of the special and exceptional solemnity of this ceremony. So it's an article of papal vesture which will be we foresee will be used again at the most important and most solemn ceremonies. And certainly, Don, the canonization of saints has always been one of the most exceptional ceremonies in the Church and one of the most solemn and grandiose ceremonies that we see.
That's certainly true. The ceremony of canonization here, we'll see another one of the changes of the canonization will occur at the beginning of Mass, or before the beginning of the Mass proper. And as Monsignor Marini, the Papal Master of Ceremonies, has said, this is to underscore the great importance of the act of canonization, even above that of beatification. This is one of the most solemn moments in the Church and in the Church's life, and you will see that reflected in both the prayers and in the canonization proper.
And in fact, the renewed importance of the canonization rite is underscored as well by the fact that typically in the pontificate of Benedict the 16th, and very deliberately, the canonization of saints is reserved to the Pope, whereas beatification is generally celebrated by a representative of the Pope in the home diocese of the individual. And now we begin the second part. The Pope has venerated and incensed the altar, and we're beginning the second part of the Litany of Saints.
This separation of canonization, beatification, goes back to the very early practice of the Church, where elevations occurred by bishops of the local dioceses, and also underscores the very special and significant ecclesial nature of a canonization. The Pope will now proceed directly to the rite of canonization at the beginning here.
Amen.
And at the conclusion of the Litany of the Saints, the Cardinal Prefect for the Congregation of the Causes of Saints, Cardinal Angelo Amato, will approach the Holy Father with the postulators, those who have promoted the causes of these seven men and women, and they will solemnly request the canonization of each of our seven new saints.
And this is, in essence, a ritual repetition of the consistory at which the Pope agreed to canonize these saints.
Beatissime Pater, instanter postulat Sancta Mater Ecclesia per sanctitatem vestram, catalogo sanctorum adscribi, et tamquam sanctos ab omnibus Christi fidelibus pronunciari beatos Iacobum Bertieu, Petrum Calum Sod, Ioannem Baptistam Pia Marta, Maria a Monte Carmelo Saliesi Barangueras, Maria Annam Coup, Catarina Tecaquita, et Annam Schaeffer.
Most Holy Father, Holy Mother Church earnestly beseeches Your Holiness to enroll the blessed among the saints. The Holy Father responds.
Fratres carissimi, Deo Pati omnipotenti, preces nostras, per Iesum Christum vivimus, ut Beata Maria Virginis et Omnium Sanctorum Sorum intercessione, sua gratia sustiniat, id quod solemnita acturi sumus.
Dear brothers, let us lift up our prayers to God the Father Almighty through Jesus Christ, that through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all His saints, He may sustain with His grace the act which we now solemnly undertake.
Per Christum Dominum Nostrum.
We ask You, O Lord, graciously to accept the prayers of Your people, that our devoted service may be pleasing to You and contribute to the growth of Your Church. And now a second solemn petition and request for the canonization of the saints.
Unanima precazione roborata, Beatissime Pater, Sancta Ecclesia instantius flagitat, ut sanctitas vestra, filios os ipsius electus, in sanctorum catalogo annumeret.
Most Holy Father, strengthened by unanimous prayer, Holy Church more earnestly beseeches Your Holiness to enroll these, her children, among the saints. And the Holy Father will pray to the Holy Spirit to guide this decision of His. Let us then invoke the Holy Spirit, the giver of life, that He may enlighten our minds and that Christ the Lord may not permit His Church to err in a matter of such importance.
Spiritum vivificantem ige invocemus, ut mentem nostram illuminet, atque Christus Dominus ne permittat errare ecclesiam suam in tanto negotio.
And we have the solemn chant of the Veni Creator Spiritus, invoking the Holy Spirit on this very solemn and important moment.
Thank you.
And as the congregation, people, and priests join in singing the invocation to the Holy Spirit, that having been completed, the prefect makes the third solemn petition. Most Holy Father, Holy Church, trusting in the Lord's promise to send upon her the Spirit of Truth, when every age keeps the supreme magisterium immune from error, most earnestly beseeches your holiness to enroll these, her elect, among the saints.
Beatissime Pater, Sancta Ecclesia, Domini promisso nixa spiritum veritatis in semitendi, qui omni tempore supremum magisterium erroris expertem reddit, instantissime supplicat sanctitatem vestram, ut os ipsius electos in sanctorum catalogum referat.
And the Holy Father will proceed to the actual beatification and the canonization, and this is the moment when the saints will be officially canonized.
Ad honorem sancte individue trinitatis, ad exaltationem fidei catholici, et vitae Christianae incrementum, auctoritate Domini nostri Iesu Christi, beatorum apostolorum Petri et Pauli, ac nostra, matura deliberazione prehabita, et divina ob esepios implorata, ac de plurimorum fratum nostrum consilio, beatus, Jacobum Berthieu, Petrum Calungsod, Ioannem Baptistam Pia Marta, Mariam a Monte Carmelo Saliesi Barangeras, Mariam Annam Cope, Catharinam Tecat Vitra, et Annam Schäfer, Sanctus esse decernimus et definimus, ac sanctorum catalogo adscribimus, statuentes eius in universa ecclesia, inter sanctus pia devotione reculi debere, in nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
For the honor of the Blessed Trinity, the exaltation of the Catholic faith, and the increase of the Christian life, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, and of the holy apostles Peter and Paul, and of us, after due deliberation and frequent prayer for divine assistance, and having sought the counsel of many of our brother bishops, we declare and define these saints to be blessed and enrolled among the saints, decreeing that they are to be venerated as such by the whole Church, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
And as the Te Deum was sung, the solemn hymn of thanksgiving of the Catholic Church, a procession was made of members of the Causes of Saints, those who are associated with the saints who have been canonized, have borne their relics in solemn procession to the Holy Father, who was given a chance to be the first to venerate the relics as relics of saints, whom he has now canonized, and now they are being set up on pedestals very close to the high altar, where the faithful will have a chance to offer their own veneration to the relics of the new saints. For those watching on television, you'll notice that there are relics of six of the new saints. The martyr, Pedro Calangsad, when he was martyred, his body was cast into the ocean and was not recovered, so there are no first-class saints, relics of Saint Pedro, but the other saints certainly have relics, and it is certainly a part of the Catholic faith that the saints' relics, the portions of their body that served as temples of the Holy Spirit in life, are the worthy objects of veneration of saints after their death, and in recognition of the fact that their bodies will be reunited with their souls at the end of time. Now the Cardinal Prefect is offering thanksgiving for the canonization.
Nomine Sancte Ecclesiae, enixas gratias hago, de pronunciazione a sanctitate vestra facta, ac humiliter peto ut eadem sanctitas vestra super per acta canonizzazione litteras apostolicas dignetur decernere.
Most Holy Father, in the name of Holy Church, I thank Your Holiness for making this proclamation and humbly request that You decree the apostolic letter concerning the act of canonization be drawn up. As we have mentioned, the canonization of saints is one of the most solemn in the Church.
Siamo tutti invitati, pertanto, a evitare gli applausi e a non innalzare bandiere o striscioni.
It is kindly asked that we maintain a climate of silence and of prayer in order to participate more fruitfully in the Eucharistic celebration. One is asked to refrain both from applause and from displaying flags or banners.
And certainly one of the great concerns of Pope Benedict in his pontificate has been the care for the sacred liturgy, the summit of the Christian faith. And so we hear in different languages, including English, as you've just heard, the instruction and encouragement to the faithful to recall that although there's certainly a festive atmosphere here in St. Peter's Square, that during the liturgy itself, they've been asked to refrain from applause, from waving their banners, and certainly there will be a time for that later, but the church, at the instruction of the Holy Father, is recalling that this sacred ceremony is, in fact, the high moment of our Catholic faith, and to keep that in mind as we maintain an atmosphere of reverence during the liturgy.
And indeed, what's called the noble simplicity of the Roman Rite, our great joy at this one of the most joyous occasions of the Church's life, expressed in that wonderful prayer, the Te Deum, which was just sung by the Vatican Choir.
In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
Amen.
Pax vobis.
Et cum Spiritu tuo.
Frates, agnoscamus peccata nostra, ut aptissimus a sacra mysteria celebranda.
The Penitential Rite.
Miserere nostri, Domine.
Quia peccatibus tibi.
Osteni nobis, Domine, misericordiam tuam.
Et salutare cura nobis.
Miseriato nostri omnipotens Deus, et dimissis peccatis nostris, perducat nos ad vitam aeternam. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Holy Father will read the collect, the prayers for today's Mass.
Oremus, omnipotens sempiterne Deus, fac nos tibi sempre et divutam cerere voluntatem, et maestate tui sincero corde servire, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum Filium Tuum, qui tecum vivit regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Almighty ever-living God, grant that we may always conform our will to yours and serve your majesty in sincerity of heart. The first reading.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has been pleased to crush his servant with suffering. If he offers his life in atonement, he shall see his heirs. He shall have a long life, and through him what the Lord wishes will be done. His soul's anguish over, he shall see the light and be content. By his sufferings shall my servant justify many, taking their faults on himself.
Verá su descendencia, prolongará sus años. Lo que el Señor quiere prosperará por su mano. Por los trabajos de su alma, verá la luz. El justo se saciará de conocimiento. Mi siervo justificará a muchos, porque cargó con los crímenes de ellos.
Per Domini.
The response for the responsorial psalm, May your love be upon us, O Lord, as we place all our hope in you. The second reading.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Since in Jesus, the Son of God, we have the supreme high priest who has gone through to the highest heaven, we must never let go of the faith that we have professed. For it is not as if we had a high priest who was incapable of feeling our weaknesses with us, but we have one who has been tempted in every way that we are, though he is without sin. Let us be confident then in approaching the throne of grace, that we shall have mercy from him and find grace when we are in need of help.
En effet, le grand prêtre que nous avons n'est pas incapable, lui, de partager nos faiblesses en toutes choses. Il a connu l'épreuve comme nous et il n'a pas péché. Avançons-nous donc avec pleine assurance vers le Dieu Tout-Puissant qui fait grâce pour obtenir miséricorde et recevoir en temps voulu la grâce de son secours.
Per bon Domini.
Two deacons bearing the books of the Gospels prepare to read the Gospel, as is customary in very solemn papal masses. The Gospel is chanted in both Latin and Greek to represent the diversity of the whole Church and the universal nature of the papal celebration.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Marcum.
Gloria tibi, Domine.
In illo tempore accedunt ad Iesum Iacobus et Johannes, filii Zebedei, dicentes ei: Magister, volumus ut quodcumque petierimus a te facias nobis. A te ledixit is, qui vultis ut faciam vobis. Ili autem dixerunt ei, da nobis ut unus ad dexteram tuam, et alius ad sinistram sediamus in gloria tua. Iesus autem aetis, nescitis quid petatis, potestis bibere calicem, quem ego bibo, aut baptismum, quo ego baptitur baptizari. At illi dixerunt ii, possumus. Iesus autem aetis, calicem quidem, quem ego bibo bibitis, et baptismum, quo ego baptitur baptizabimini, sidere autem ad dexteram meam, vel ad sinistram, non est meum dare, sed quibus paratum est. Et audientes dicem cupierunt indignari di Jacobo et Ioanne. Et vocans ius Iesus ait illis, scitis quia hi, qui videntur principari gentibus, dominantur is, et principes eorum potestatem habent ipsorum. Non ita est autem in vobis, sed quicumque voluerit fieri major inter vos, erit vester minister, et quicumque voluerit in vobis primus esse, erit omnium servus. Nam et filius hominis non venit, ut ministraritur ei, sed ut ministraret, et daret animam suam redemptionem pro multis.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, approached Jesus. Master, they said to him, we want you to do us a favor. He said to them, what is it you want me to do for you? They said to him, allow us to sit, one at your right hand, the other at your left, in your glory. You do not know what you are asking, Jesus said to them. Can you drink the cup that I must drink, or be baptized with the baptism with which I must be baptized? They replied, we can. Jesus said to them, the cup that I must drink, you shall drink, and with the baptism with which I must be baptized, you shall be baptized. But as for seats at my right hand or my left, those are not mine to grant. They belong to those to whom they have been allotted. When the other ten heard this, they began to feel indignant with James and John. So Jesus called them to him and said to them, you know that among the pagans, their so-called rulers lord it over them, and their great men make their authority felt. This has not happened among you. No, anyone who wants to become great among you must be your servant, and anyone who wants to be first among you must be slave to all. For the Son of Man himself did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many.
Κοινο προσπορεύονται Ιησού, Ιάκωβος και Ιωάννης, οι δύο Ζεβεδαίο, λέγοντες αυτό. Διδάσκαλε, θέλομεν να ο εάν ετήσομεν σε ποιήσε σημείς. ημίνα Ιησού εδεξιών και εις εξ αριστερών, καθίσομεν εν τη δόξη σου. Ο δε Ιησούς είπεν αυτοίς, ουκ είδατε διαιτήστε, δύναστε πειν το ποτήριο εγώ πίνω, ή το βάπτισμα ο εγώ βαπτίζομαι βαπτιστήνε. Ή δε είπαν αυτό, δυνάμεθα, ο δε Ιησούς είπεν αυτοίς, το ποτήριο εγώ πίνω πίστε, και το βάπτισμα ο εγώ βαπτίζομεν βαπτιστείς εστέ, το δε καθίσει εκ δεξιών μου, η εξεβονίμων ουκ εστίμων δούνε, αλλο εισι θυμάστε. Και ακούσαντες οι δέκα ήρξαν το αντακανακτήν περί Ιακώβου και Ιωάννου, και προσκαλεσάμενος αυτούς, ο Ιησούς λέγει αυτοίς, είδατε ότι δογκούντες αρχήν το εθνόν κατακυριεύωσιν αυτόν, και οι μεγάλοι αυτόν κατεξουσιάζωσιν αυτόν, ουχ αυτός δέστη εν ημίν. Αλλο όσαν θέλει μέγας γενέστη εν ημίν, εστιμών διάκονος, και όσαν θέλει εν ημίν, είναι πρώτος, εστί πάντων δούλος. Κι γάρο Υιός τον τρόπο κι την διακονητήν, αλλά διακονήσε και δούνε την ψυχήν αυτού, λύτρο ανθυπολό.
Holy Father will kiss the book of the Gospels, and with the book of the Gospels will bless the assembled people. Greek deacon approaches the Holy Father with the book of the Gospels. And the choir responds with the Greek chant, Ad multos annos, many years, Holy Father, a traditional formula of encouragement and best wishes for the Holy Father. The Holy Father is taking his homily from the text, "The Son of Man came to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many."
Il figlio dell'uomo è venuto per servire e dare la propria vita in riscatto per molti. Venerati fratelli, cari fratelli e sorelle, oggi la Chiesa ascolta ancora una volta.
Dear brothers, dear brother bishops, dear brothers and sisters, today the Church listens again to these words of Jesus spoken by the Lord during his journey to Jerusalem, where he was to accomplish the mystery of his passion, death, and resurrection. They are words which enshrine the meaning of Christ's mission on earth, marked by his sacrifice, by his total self-giving. On this third Sunday of October, on which we celebrate World Mission Sunday, the Church listens to them with special attention and renews her conviction that she should always be fully dedicated to serve mankind and the gospel after the example of the one who gave himself up, even to the sacrifice of life.
Era viva la consapevolezza di essere tutta intera in perenne stato di servizio all'uomo e al Vangelo, come colui che ha offerto se stesso fino al sacrificio della vita. Rivolgo il mio cordiale saluto a tutti voi che riempite.
I extend warm greetings to all of you who fill St. Peter's Square, especially the official delegations and the pilgrims who have come to celebrate the seven new saints. I greet with affection the cardinals and bishops who during these days are taking part in the synodal assembly in the new evangelization. The coincidence between this ecclesiastical meeting and World Mission Sunday is a happy one, and the Word of God that we have listened to sheds light on both subjects. It shows how to be evangelizers, called to bear witness and to proclaim the Christian message, configuring ourselves to Christ and following His very path. This is true both for the mission ad gentes and for the new evangelization in places with ancient Christian roots.
Chiamato a testimoniare ed annunciare il messaggio cristiano, conformandosi a Gesù Cristo, seguendo la sua stessa vita. Questo vale sia per la missione accente, sia per la nuova evangelizzazione nelle regioni di antica cristianità. Il Figlio dell'uomo è venuto per servire e dare la propria vita in riscatto per molti.
The Son of Man came to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. These words were the blueprint for living of the seven blessed men and women that the Church solemnly enrolls this morning in the glorious ranks of the saints. With heroic courage, they spent their lives in total consecration to the Lord and in the generous service of their brethren. They are sons and daughters of the Church who chose the path of service following the Lord. Holiness always rises up in the Church from the wellspring of the mystery of redemption, as foretold by the prophet Isaiah in the first reading. The servant of the Lord is the righteous one who shall make many to be accounted as righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. He is Jesus Christ, crucified, risen, and living in glory. Today's canonization is an eloquent confirmation of this mysterious saving reality. The tenacious profession of faith of these seven generous disciples of Christ, their configuration to the Son of Man, shines out brightly today in the whole Church.
L'odierna canonizzazione costituisce un'eloquente conferma di tale misteriosa realtà salvifica. La tenace professione di fede di questi sette generosi discepoli di Cristo, la loro conformazione al Figlio dell'uomo risplende oggi in tutta la Chiesa.
Jacques Berthieu, born in 1838 in France, was passionate about Jesus Christ at an early age. During his parish ministry, he had the burning desire to save souls. Becoming a Jesuit, he wished to journey through the world for the glory of God. A tireless pastor on the island of Sainte-Marie, then in Madagascar, he struggled against injustice while bringing succor to the poor and sick. The Malagasies, thought of him as a priest come down from heaven, saying, You are our father and mother. He made himself all things to all men, drawing from prayer and his love of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, the human and priestly force, to face martyrdom in 1896. He died saying, I prefer to die rather than renounce my faith. Dear friends, may the life of this evangelizer be an encouragement and a model for priests that, like him, they will be men of God. May his example aid the many Christians of today persecuted for their faith. In this year of faith, may his intercession bring forth many fruits for Madagascar and the African continent. May God bless the Malagasy people.
Chers amis, que la vie de cet évangélisateur soit un encouragement, un modèle pour les prêtres, afin qu'ils soient des hommes de Dieu comme lui. Que son exemple aide les nombreux chrétiens persécutés aujourd'hui à cause de leur foi. Puisse en cette année de la foi son intercession porter des fruits pour Madagascar et le continent africain. Que Dieu bénisse le peuple malgache. Peter Kalungsod was born around the year 1654 in the Visayas region of the Philippines. His love for Christ inspired him to train as a catechist with the Jesuit missionaries there. In 1668, along with other young catechists, he accompanied Father Diego Luis de San Victores to the Marianas Islands in order to evangelize the Chamorro people. Life there was hard. The missionaries faced persecution arising from envy and slander. Pedro, however, displayed deep faith and charity and continued to catechize his many converts, giving witness to Christ by a life of purity and dedication to the gospel. Uppermost was his desire to win souls for Christ, and this made him resolute in accepting martyrdom. He died on the 2nd April, 1672. Witnesses record that Peter could have fled for safety, but chose to stay at Father Diego's side. The priest was able to give Peter absolution before he himself was killed. May the example and courageous witness of Pedro Kalungsod inspire the dear people of the Philippines to announce the kingdom bravely and to win souls for God. Giovanni Battista Pia Marta,
priest of the Diocese of Brescia, was a great apostle of charity and of young people. He raised awareness of the need for a cultural and social presence of Catholicism in the modern world, and so he dedicated himself to the Christian, moral, and professional growth of the younger generations with an enlightened input of humanity and goodness. Animated by unshakable faith in divine providence and by a profound spirit of sacrifice, he faced difficulties and fatigue to breathe life into various apostolic works, including the Artigianelli Institute, Querignana Publishers, and the Congregation of the Holy Family of Nazareth for men, and for women the Congregation of the Humble Sister Servants of the Lord. The secret of his intense and busy life is found in the long hours he gave to prayer. When he was overburdened with work, he increased the length of his encounter heart to heart with the Lord. He preferred to pause before the Blessed Sacrament, meditating upon the Passion, Death, and Resurrection of Christ, to gain spiritual fortitude and return to gaining people's hearts, especially the young, to bring them back to the sources of life with fresh pastoral initiatives.
Il segreto della sua intensa ed operosa vita sta nelle lunghe ore che le dedicava alla preghiera. Quando era oberato di lavoro, aumentava il tempo per l'incontro cuore e cuore con il Signore. Preferiva le soste davanti al Santissimo Sacramento, meditando la passione, morte e risurrezione di Cristo, per attingere forza spirituale e ripartire alla conquista del cuore della gente, specie dei giovani, per ricondurre alle sorgenti della vita con sempre nuove iniziative pastorali. Che tu misericordia, Signor, venga sopra nosotros come lo speramos de ti.
May your love be upon us, O Lord, as we place all our hope in you. With these words, the liturgy invites us to make our own this hymn to God, Creator and Provider, accepting his plan into our lives. Maria Carmelo Sales y Barangueras, a religious born in Vic in Spain in 1848, did just so. Filled with hope in spite of many trials, she, on seeing the progress of the Congregation of the Conceptionist Missionary Sisters of Teaching, which she founded in 1892, was able to sing with the Mother of God, His mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. Her educational work, entrusted to the Immaculate Virgin Mary, continues to bear abundant fruit among young people, through the generous dedication of her daughters who, like her, entrust themselves to God for whom all is possible.
Su obra educativa confiada a la Virgen Inmaculada sigue dando abundantes frutos entre la juventud a través de la entrega generosa de sus hijas que como ellas se encomiendan al Dios que todo lo puede. I now turn to Marianne Koop, born in 1838 in Heppenheim, Germany. Only 1 year old when taken to the United States, in 1862 she entered the Third Order Regular of St. Francis at Syracuse, New York. Later, Superior General of her congregation, Mother Marianne willingly embraced a call to care for the lepers of Hawaii after many others had refused. She personally went with six of her fellow sisters to manage a hospital on Oahu, later founding Malulani Hospital on Maui and opening a home for girls whose parents were lepers. 5 years after that, she accepted the invitation to open a home for women and girls on the island of Molokai itself, bravely going there herself, effectively ending her contact with the outside world. There she looked after Father Damien, already famous for his heroic work among the lepers, nursed him as he died, and took over his work among male lepers. At a time when little could be done for his suffering, from this terrible disease, Marianne Koop showed the highest love, courage, and enthusiasm. She's a shining and energetic example of the best of the tradition of Catholic nursing sisters and of the spirit of her beloved Saint Francis. Gadile de Cadwitar was born in today's New York State in 1656 to Mohawk Father, the Christian Algonquin mother, who gave to her a sense of the living God. She was baptized at 20 years of age, and to escape persecution, she took refuge in St. Francis Xavier Mission near Montreal. There she worked, faithful to the traditions of her people, also renouncing her religious convictions until her death at the age of 24. Leading a simple life, Gadeli remained faithful to her love for Jesus, to prayer, and to daily mass. Her greatest wish was to know and to do what pleased God. Gadeli nous impressionne par l'action de la grâce dans sa vie, en l'absence de soutien.
Kateri impresses us by the action of grace in her life, in spite of the absence of external help, and by the courage of her vocation, so unusual in her culture. In her, faith and culture enrich each other. May her example help us to live where we are, loving Jesus without denying who we are. Saint Kateri, Protectress of Canada, and the first Native American saint, we entrust to you the renewal of the faith in the First Nations and in all of North America. May God bless the First Nations.
Que Dieu bénisse les Premières Nations. Anna Schäfer aus Mindelstetten wollte als Jugendliche.
Anna Schäfer from Mindelstetten, as a young woman, wished to enter a missionary order. She came from a poor background, so, in order to earn the dowry needed for acceptance into the cloister, she worked as a maid. One day, she suffered a terrible accident and received incurable burns on her legs, which forced her to be bedridden for the rest of her life. So her sickbed became her cloister cell, and her suffering a missionary service. She struggled for a time to accept her fate, but then understood her situation as a loving call from the crucified one to follow him. Strengthened by daily communion, she became an untiring intercessor in prayer and a mirror of God's love for the many who sought her counsel. May her apostolate of prayer and suffering, of sacrifice and expiation, be a shining example for believers in her homeland, and may her intercession strengthen the Christian hospice movement in its beneficial activity.
Wurde sie zu einer unermüdlichen Fürsprecherin im Gebet und zu einem Spiegel der Liebe Gottes für viele Ratsuchende. Ihr Apostolat des Betens und des Leidens, des Opferns und des Sühnens sei den Gläubigen in ihrer Heimat ein leuchtendes Vorbild. Ihre Fürbitte stärke die christliche Hospizbewegung in ihrem segensreichen Wirken. Cari fratelli e sorelle, questi nuovi santi, diversi per origine, lingua, nazione.
Dear brothers and sisters, these new saints, different in origin, language, nationality, and social condition, are united among themselves and with the whole people of God in the mystery of salvation of Christ the Redeemer. With them, we too, together with the Synod Fathers from all parts of the world, proclaim to the Lord in the words of the psalm that He is our help and our shield. And we invoke him, saying, May your love be upon us, O Lord, as we place all our hope in you. May the witness of these new saints and their lives generously spent for the love of Christ speak today to the whole church, and may their intercession strengthen and sustain her in her mission to proclaim the gospel to the whole world.
Nella sua missione di annunciare il Vangelo al mondo intero. Amen.
And the Holy Father, having concluded his homily, we pause for a moment of silent reflection.
A meditare in silenzio.
Let us reflect in silence for some brief moments.
Meditemos brevemente en silencio.
And now we prepare for the solemn chanting of the Creed.
Credo in unum Deum.
Thank you.
Fratelli carissimi, confortati dalla testimonianza di fede dei santi, innalziamo con fiducia la nostra preghiera a Dio, Padre onnipotente e misericordioso.
The universal prayer, or prayers of the faithful, dear brothers and sisters, confirmed by the witness of faith given by the saints, let us confidently raise our prayer to God, the Almighty and Merciful Father.
O God, source of all holiness, through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Queen of all saints, renew the beauty of the Church, the Bride of Christ.
Dominum de precemur,
erodamus salvinos.
O God, source of all holiness, through the intercession of the holy martyrs, grant fidelity and strength to those persecuted for the faith.
Nain ki on ala se
Dominum de precemur,
te laudamus
Ó Deus, fonte de toda santidade.
O God, source of all holiness, through the intercession of the holy pastors of your people, send many zealous priests for the salvation of mankind.
Sacerdotes numerosos e zelosos para a salvação dos homens.
Dominum de precemur,
te laudamus salvinos.
O Dios, tuburan sa matag kabalaanan.
O God, source of all holiness, through the intercession of the holy virgins, preserve our young people in integrity and in the joy of your friendship.
Itugot ng ang tanang mga batan-on, magpabilin diha sa kaligdong o sa kalipay sa pagpakighigala kanimo.
Dominum de precemur,
te rogamus salvinos.
Gott, du Quelle aller Heiligkeit.
O God, source of all holiness, through the intercession of the saints who lived heroic charity, provide for the needs of the poor, the suffering, and all the distressed.
Den Leidenden und den Verzagten neuen Mut.
Dominum de precemur,
te rogamus salvinos.
Salga a te, o Padre, la voce dei tuoi figli. Accogli con benevolenza la preghiera che ti presentiamo nella comunione dei santi. Per Cristo nostro Signore.
Father, may the voice of your children rise up to you. Graciously hear the prayers which we present to you in the communion of saints. And in the prayers of the faithful, we heard intercessions in English, in Mohawk, in Portuguese, in Cebuano, the language of the Philippines, one of the many languages of the Philippines, and in German. And now we have the offertory procession making its way to the Holy Father at the high altar here in St. Peter's Square.
Thank you.
the Holy Father offers the gifts of bread and wine, which will become the body and blood of Christ. The principal concelebrants at this Mass, of course, all of the bishops and priests will be concelebrating. The principal concelebrants include cardinals representing the different nations who have had people canonized. They will be Ricardo Vidal, Archbishop Emeritus of Cebu in the Philippines, Antonio Maria Rocco Varela, Archbishop of Madrid, Carlos Amigo Vallejo, Archbishop Emeritus of Seville, Luis Martinez Sistach, Archbishop of Barcelona in Spain as well, Odilo Pedro Scherer, Archbishop of Sao Paulo, and Timothy Michael Dolan, the Archbishop of New York. They will be the six cardinals who will be the first of the principal concelebrants with the Holy Father during this Mass. And the Holy Father is incensing the gifts and the altar. Preface and the Eucharistic prayer, as is common in papal ceremonies, will be in Latin. This morning the Holy Father will be praying the third Eucharistic prayer, which offers the option of mentioning the saints in the commemoration of the living. So the Holy Father will have the opportunity to invoke the names of all of our seven new saints in the canon.
Fratres ut mihi magnum sacrificium acceptabile fiat ab Deum Patrem omnipotentem. Tribui nos Domine quesumus donis tuis liberamente servire, ut sua purificante nos gratia, istem quibus famulam mysteris emundimur, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Grant us, Lord, we pray, a sincere respect for your gifts, that through the purifying action of your grace we may be cleansed by the very mysteries we serve.
Sagamus Domino Deo nostro. Veridinem et justum est equum et salutare, nos tibi sempre et ubique gratias acere, Domine Sancte Pater omnipotens eterne Deus, in quo vivimus movimur et sumus, atque in hoc corpore constituti, non solum pietatis tue quotidianus experimur effectus, sed eternitatis etiam pignoraiam tenemus. Primitias enim spiritus abentes, pecem suscitas diisum a mortuis, pascale mysterium, speramus nobis esse perpetuum. Und et nos tibi gratias agimus, et tuas virtutes cum ansis predicamus dicentes. Sanctus est Domine, et meritus te laudat omnes a te condita creatura, quia per filium tuum Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum, Spiritus Sancti operante virtute, vivificas et sanctificas universa, et populum tibi congregare non desinis, ut a solis ordo escut ocasum, oblatio munda offerato nomine tuo. Subnisis ergo te Domine te peccamur, ut ec munda recetibi sacranda detulimus, iudem Spiritus sanctificare denieris, ut corpus et sanguis fiant filii tui Dominus Iesu Christi, cuius mandato hec mysteria exercimus.
The consecration of the sacred body of Christ.
Tradibat accipit panem, et tibi gratias agens benedixit, fregit, deditque discipulis suis dicens, accipit et manducate ex hoc omnes, hoc est enim corpus meum, quod pro vobis traditur. Simile modo postquam cenatus.
And the consecration of the precious blood of Christ.
Et tibi gratias agens benedixit, deditque discipulis suis dicens, accipit et bibite ex eo omnes, hic est enim calix sanguinis mei, novi et eterni testamenti, qui pro vobis et pro multis effunditur in remissionem peccatorum, hoc facit in meam commemorationem. Mysterium fidei. Domine, iustem fili tui salutifere passionis, nec non mirabilis resurrectionis et ascensionis in celum, sed et prestolantes altrem ius adventum, offerimus tibi gratias referentes, hoc sacrificium vivum et sanctum. Respice quesum in oblationem ecclesiae tue, et agnoscens hostiam cuius voluisti emulazione placari, Concitus vi corpo et sangue Filii Tui Reficimur, Spiritus Sancti repleti, unum corpus et unum spiritus inveniamur in Christo.
The commemoration of the saints.
Tibi perficiat munus eternum, ut cum electis tui salititatem consequi valiamus, in primis cum beatissima Virgine, de genitrice Maria, cum beatis apostolis tuis et gloriosis martyribus, cum tuis sanctis, Jacobo, Petro, Giovanni Baptista, Maria Monte Carmelo, Maria Anna, Caterina et Anna, et omnibus sanctis, quorum ti, quorum intercessione perpetua apo te confidimus adiubare.
Ec ostia nostra reconciliationis proficia quae sumus Domine, ad ocius mundi pacem et atque salutem. Ecclesiam tuam peregrinantem in terra, in fide caritate firmare digneris, cum famulo tuo Papa nostro Benedicto, un episcopali ordini et universu clero, et omni populo adquisitionis tue. Votis uius familiae quantibi astare voluisti ad esto propitius. Ones filios tuos subique dispersus, tibi clemens pater miseratur conjunce. Fratres nostros defuntos et omnes qui tibi placentes ex hoc saeculo transierunt, in regnum tuum benignus admite, ubi fore esperamus, ut simul gloria tua perenni tersatiemur. Per Christum Dominum nostrum, per quem mundo bona cunta larsiris.
Per ipsum et cum ipso et in ipso, est tibi Deo Patri omnipotenti, in unitate Spiritus Sancti, omnis honor et gloria, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen. We recite together the Our Father.
Recepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audimus dicere, Pater
noster, qui est in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, ad veniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, in cielo et in terra. Pane nostro quotidiano da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in
libera nos quesumus Domine ab omnibus malis, da propitius pacem in diebus nostris, ut opi misericordiae tu adiuti, et a peccatus imus empa liberi, et ab omni perturbatione securi, expectantes beatam spem, et adventum salvatoris nostri Iesu Christi.
Tuum est regnum et potestas, et gloria in saecula.
Domine Iesu Christi, qui dixisti apostolis tuis, pacem relinquo vobis, pacem iam do vobis, ne respicias peccata nostra, sed fidem ecclesiae tue, iamque secondo voluntatem tuam pacificare, et quod anaret in ieris qui vivis et regnas in saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobis cum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Offerte vobis pacem.
And the sign of peace is exchanged. And the Agnus Dei begins.
Agnus Dei, ecce qui tollit peccata mundi, beati qui accionam anni vocati sunt. Domine, non sum dignus ut inter subtecto meo, se tantum dicverbo et sanabitur anima mia. Corpus Christi custodem.
Distribution of Holy Communion. The Holy Father distributes Holy Communion to a very small number of the representatives who are here for the canonizations. And of course, as has become customary, the Holy Father distributes Holy Communion to those individuals kneeling and on the tongue. as he concludes the distribution of Holy Father, the distribution of Holy Communion, the Holy Father descends from the altar to offer Holy Communion to a number of wheelchair-bound communicants who have also been chosen to receive from the hands of the Holy Father himself. As we conclude the distribution of Holy Communion, the hymns of communion, we'll pause for a moment of silence and reflection.
Oh,
Rimaniamo alcuni istanti in silenzio orante.
Let us maintain prayerful silence for some brief moments.
Guardemos silencio durante unos instantes y permanezcamos en oración.
Oremus, facnos quesmus Domine, celestium rerum frequentatione proficere, ut et temporalibus beneficis adiuvimur, et erudiamur aeternis, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that benefiting from participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what you give in this present age and prepared for the gifts that are eternal. And after the post-communion, the Holy Father will offer the reflection for the Angelus prayer before the final blessing of the
Cari
Mass.
Fratelli e sorelle, prima di concludere questa celebrazione,
dear brothers and sisters, before concluding this celebration, let us turn ourselves to the Queen of all the Saints, the Virgin Mary, with a thought for Lourdes, stricken by a grave flood of its river, which has gotten even to the grotto of the apparitions of Our Lady. In particular, we wish today to entrust to the maternal protection of the Virgin Mary all missionaries, priests, religious, and lay, which in all parts of the world spread the good seed of the gospel. We pray also for the Synod of Bishops, which in this week is confronting with trust the new evangelization for the transmission of the Christian faith.
Preghiamo anche per il Sinodo dei Vescovi, che in queste settimane si sta confrontando con la sfida della nuova evangelizzazione per la trasmissione della fede cristiana. Je salue cordialement les pèlerins francophones.
I also greet the French-speaking pilgrims, notably the official delegations of Canada, of Madagascar, and France, come to Rome for the canonization of Father Jacques Berthieu and Kateri Tekakwitha. Following the example of these new saints, we encourage them to encounter the love of Christ in their lives and testimony of their author, which we also pray that many youths may respond to the call of the Lord to live and announce the gospel. We entrust the churches of these places to their protection. I bless you from my heart and also your families. Good pilgrimage to you.
Je vous bénis tout de grand cœur, ainsi que vos familles. Bon pèlerinage à tous. On the happy occasion of the canonization today, I greet the official delegations and all the English-speaking pilgrims and visitors, especially those from the Philippines, Canada, and the United States of America. May the holiness and witness of the saints inspire us to draw closer to the Son of God, who for such great love came to serve and offer his life for our salvation. God bless you all.
And the Holy Father will continue with greetings in German, Spanish.
Ein herzliches Grüß Gott sage ich allen deutschsprachigen Gästen, besonders.
A cordial salutation to all of the guests speaking the German language, in particular to the delegation from of officials from Bavaria and many pilgrims from the Diocese of Regensburg. To watch in one's heart the profundity of the heart of God, this is what has moved Saint Anna Schaefer in her laboratory of suffering. For this we can recognize with the love of God in our difficulties, which cannot become greater than they than when they are given as a gift from others. The new saints, with their example and their intercession, may they reinforce our faith, and may they help us also to be witnesses and announcers of the gospel.
In particular, la delegación oficial de España.
The Holy Father also salutes pilgrims from the Spanish-speaking lands, in particular the official delegation from Spain, also the bishops and faithful, also present for the canonization of Mother Carmen Sáenz y Barrangueras. She exhorted all, but especially her daughters, the religious conceptionist missionaries of hope, to approach and meditate faithfully in their hearts on the Word of God, raising with spiritual practice of service and confidence and humility the example of the Immaculate Virgin Mary. May, with the help of the intercession of the new saints, may each time may they announce and give testimony with valor to the gospel of Jesus Christ, especially among the youth. Blessed Sunday. We give warm greetings to the Polish speakers. The new saints, which we introduced today in the World Mission Week, in particular way, they sustain us spiritually, and we must sustain spiritually and materially those who announce Christ in different continents. We give thanks for all of them who, among them, the pontifical missionary workers, they may take the care of the missions in all the world. The year of faith should relight in Poland the missionary enthusiasm for the church and of faithful laymen. We bless you from our hearts. The Holy Father also sends a cordial salutation to the official Italian delegation and also to all pilgrims coming to celebrate the canonization of Giovanni Battista Piamarta, in particular to the members of the Institute that he has founded. May they, with him, be always united in intense prayer and generous service to those who are near them, to their neighbors.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tu mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Jesus. Ecce ancilla Domini. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tu mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Jesus.
Santa Maria, Madre Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus.
Et verbum caro factum est. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tu mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Jesus.
Santa Maria, Madre Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis
nostrae. Amen. Ora pro nobis Sancta Dei genetrix. Oremus, gratiam tuam quesumus Domine, mentibus nostris infunde, ut qui angelo nunciante, Christi Filii de Incarnation coniovimus, per passionem eius et crucem, ad resurrectionis gloriam perducamur, per undem Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Gloria Patri et Filii et Spiritui Sancto. Gloria Patri et Filii et Spiritui Sancto. Gloria Patri et Filii et Spiritui Sancto.
Sicut erat in principio et nunc et semper et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Pro fidelibus defunctis, requiem aeternam dona eis, Domine.
Et lux perpetua luce a
Tei. Requiescant in pace.
Amen.
The blessing.
Sit nomen Domini benedictum. Adiutorium nostrum in nomine Domini. Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est.
Deo
That concludes the solemn canonization and Mass of Thanksgiving for the Sunday of World Mission Sunday. Once again, we greet all of those listening in or watching on television, especially those on Vatican Radio, on CTV, on Catholic TV, on Radio Maria Polonia, Salt and Light TV, those listening in on EWTN TV, We Are One Body Radio, Telecare TV, CBS News, Familyland TV, and Net New Evangelization TV. And we can hear the recessional music playing as the Holy Father greets the crowds and processes down from the altar. Deacons, the Holy Father reverences the altar. And once again, we see the crowds of pilgrims maintaining a reverential, if not precisely silence, at least the reverential attitude that is certainly called for at these celebrations, but certainly a joyous festive mood in the air on a beautiful Sunday morning here in Rome. I'm told there are more than 80,000 pilgrims in the square, along with hundreds of priests, and as the Holy Father has mentioned a number of times, right now we have the General Assembly of the Synod of Bishops, with cardinals and bishops, priests and laity meeting from around the world to discuss the new evangelization. The Holy Father now in the Pope Mobile, making his way through the crowds, smiling and blessing at the various members of the congregation of the people of God gathered here. And certainly a very happy and joyful look on the Holy Father's face. Was undoubtedly an exceptional moment for him. One of the high points of any pontificate is the canonization of saints and elevating saints to the highest honors the Church can give.
The ceremony of canonization, which dates back for the papacy and into the 1100s, and the formula we heard for the canonization of saints is actually the pattern for the solemn proclamation of dogma as it came to be appreciated in the church. As far back as St. Thomas Aquinas and St. Bonaventure, of whom the Pope himself is an expert, was considered by the vast majority of theologians to be an act of the solemn extraordinary papal magisterium. And so we saw that with the prayers to the Holy Spirit, the Veni Creator, the prayers that the Church might not err in making such a pronouncement. What you have seen is one of the most solemn times, one of the most joyful times in the Church's history, the exaltation and the recognition that a saint is now in heaven beholding the presence of Almighty God, a definitive declaration by the Pope that this person is to be honored on earth since they are honored in heaven and are now a intercessor for all of the faithful and may be prayed to with confidence.
And certainly all the ceremonies of today's event and the canonization itself with the Litany of Saints, with the addition in the Pope's vestments of the Fanon, with the crowds of people, the solemn concelebrants, and the overall tone of the whole ceremony has certainly spoken to that solemn exercise of the Magisterium of the Pope. Once again, we greet all of our listeners as we conclude this broadcast of the Rite of Canonization and Mass of Celebration from St. Peter's, live from St. Peter's. And once again, we greet all of our listeners at Vatican Radio and CTV, at Catholic TV, Radio Maria Polonia, Salt and Light TV, EWTN TV, We Are One Body Radio, Telecare TV, CBS News, Family Land TV, Net New Evangelization TV. And as we conclude our broadcast of the celebration this morning, following the Pope as he leaves St. Peter's Square, I'd like to thank again Dr. Donald Prudlow, who has joined me here this morning, and wish all of you a happy and holy Sunday. Laudetur Jesus Christus.
Of the special mass for the canonization of Kateri Tekakwitha. Tomorrow we will bring you full coverage of the massive thanksgiving in honor of Saint Kateri Tekakwitha. From everyone here at Salt and Light, I'm Alicia Ambrosio saying thank you for watching.